If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode, for about 18 minutes, we have some fun conversation. We talk about Castle Rock. It's a new genre of music we found on iTunes.
Yeah, Castle Rock.
or it's a place we hike in the Santa Cruz Mountains.
I like Castle Rock.
It's one of those things. Then we talk about the signs of aging. You know, our ability to tolerate alcohol,
wrinkly balls,
sleep, some of our drunken mishaps. Inability to get erection. Just kidding.
What?
And then we talk about...
I remember that part.
We talk about... we also mentioned Brain FM in this episode again. Adam talked about it in one of the questions. By the way, if you go to www.brain.fm/mindpump, you could get signed up on their awesome meditation, focus, sleep, all this cool sounds
you listen to. Get jacked in.
Yeah, you get it and you get a discount. I also mention reishi mushrooms. This is something that I use sometimes to bring my body down a couple levels, help me to relax a little bit, sleep better. The reishi mushrooms that I use are from Four Sigmatic. It's a great company that produces these products in a way that we agree with. If you want to get a discount, go to Four Sigmatic.com/mindpump. Enter the discount code mindpump. For, I think, 15% off. Get a massive discount. Then we get into the questions of this episode. Somebody asked us how we deal with a client who is hyper flexible and has a hard time feeling certain stretches.
Like Gumby-esque.
Yeah, like their IT band, their hip flexor. What kind of training should you take them through to help them with these issues? Then we talk about the differences between body weight training and lifting weights when it comes to muscle building. Is one of them superior? Find out in this episode. Then we talk about deep breathing. This particular individual asking the question has an issue with deep breathing. They always breathe shallowly, and they would like some advice on how they can get
deep breathing, heavy petting,
better breathing. That was creepy.
Yeah.
Then we talk about competitive hockey in college. This particular individual has tightness in their shins, calves, and hips. So we give them tips on how to alleviate some of those issues. Also, welcome to September. Our promotion this month is pretty exciting. We actually had a debate over whether or not we should do this because it's that much of a giveaway. So check this out. Pay attention.
Let me hear it.
Don't fast forward to this here. Don't fast forward yet. Enroll in any MAPS program or any bundle. Okay? Take your pick. Doesn't matter. As long as it's a MAPS program or a bundle. And we're going to give you MAPS Prime for free. That's right. Enroll in any of those things, get MAPS Prime absolutely free. Now, remember, MAPS Prime has a self-assessment tool in it called the Compass. It helps you assess your body so that you can design what you need to do to prime your workouts properly.
You know what this is going to do? This is going to eliminate a lot of questions.
It's going to help.
Everybody's going to be like, oh, I feel great.
Thanks, see you later. And the cool thing about Prime is you can use that with any activity or any workout. So CrossFit, swimming, football, basketball, traditional resistance training, martial arts, whatever.
Ping pong.
If you prime your body properly before that event, you perform better and then you get better results. And this is a program. It's probably one of our most popular programs. That's why we debated over it. And again, we're giving it away for free. All you got to do is enroll in MAPS, any MAPS program or any MAPS program bundle. Here's what you do. Go to mindpumpmedia.com and sign up to get all that wonderful stuff. That's not me. That's Adam.
I'm trying to decide what noise that was.
That was Adam's busy sound.
Oh, that's his Instagramming elevator music.
Hey, Justin, do you ever take your kids to Castle Rock? I think we talked about this before.
Not yet, man.
Have you been there?
I have. Long time ago, dude. I haven't been there in forever.
Dude, it's Adam. Have you been to Castle Rock?
Yeah. We just went. Remember?
Wait, Castle Rock or did you go to Pinnacles?
The one that's up in right up here above
Santa Cruz Mountains?
Yeah.
Did you climb all the boulders and stuff?
I didn't climb all the boulders.
Dude, did you see the climbers?
Yeah.
It's fucking intense, man.
People all over the place.
My kids went nuts up there. And I went with Jessica, and she's, she trained on the silks for like 4 years.
So she's got that climbing strength.
She's a monkey, dude. She'll climb anything. She's a ridiculous climber. So she's making me extremely uncomfortable by climbing on these boulders. And then my kids, who children are naturally...
You're like trying to spot.
Dude, I'm freaking out, right? Yeah. But it was cool watching my kids climb because they started getting all this confidence, like, that they can do it and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But it's fucking scary, dude. She's like getting up on the top, and then the kids are getting up on the top, and then my kids are like, Papa, come up here and climb with us. And I'm like... I'm cool. I'll stay here.
I'm down here taking pictures.
Daddy likes to watch.
Dad's taking pictures.
Yeah, no. So I didn't do any climbing on the rock.
You didn't? Man.
I did a little bit.
Sal.
I took pictures, dude. Selena. So there's evidence.
That's why we call him Selena.
Wait,
those listeners that don't know, this is why we call him Selena.
Why? Because I sing
eloquently.
Como la flor. No, I didn't. I climbed a little bit, but you didn't climb at all, Adam. So you can't talk shit.
Yeah, but I did not out of
zing.
Fear. Out of fear.
Yeah.
And most certainly, if Katrina climbed, I would have to outclimb her.
You have to out. You have to outclimb her.
Absolutely.
Why?
That's how it works. We're competitive.
Ego thing.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah, we have a competitive.
I feel like she'd be a better climber than you.
She might.
Because she's smaller. So it's easier to do that, and she's got. I mean, she reached a higher level of sports than you did, right?
Considering,
don't tell her that. We get into it. In fact, we were on the.
Do you ever play basketball with her?
Yeah, we used to consider physique a sport.
That's prime and pro.
Professional.
That's right.
I'm trying. I got your back, Adam.
Thank you. Thank you for looking out for me right there. She did go D1 college b-ball player.
Who'd she play with?
Oh my God! Don't do this.
D1. That's legit.
Fuck, down in LA right now. She's gonna kill me.
We'll edit it. Out the show.
Could you slide this?
When's your anniversary?
You don't see UCLA on the spot like that. Oh my God! I can't believe I can't think of
the Bruins.
No. Stop it, dude. She's
that's right, bitch. I know. Yeah. I know a fucking team.
You know? Which one was that?
It's
Bears. They're the bear ones.
No. The school.
Cal State.
That's the mascot. No,
Cal State
don't help
Northridge
him.
Is where she
okay,
went.
Thank
Cal
you,
State
yeah.
Northridge.
I'm trying to understand because you thought you got this.
No, I don't know anything, dude.
Come on,
what did
man.
You just call him out on? Because that's what you
I said the Bruins.
You said the Bruins. I'm like, that's great. But he didn't know which
school.
Is that
school. UCLA?
Yes.
Oh, I was going to say, you better not throw out a mascot and know not.
That's what I'm saying. I was just trying to make sure.
Let me tell you something right now, Justin. I will surprise you.
Stop it.
Fist bump.
Yeah.
Can't reach you, but we'll do that one instead.
Yeah, no, Katrina played for Cal State Northridge. Mm-hmm. And so
what position?
She was a power forward and a small forward. So she played, and she was all state defense like every year. So she was known for her defense.
Getting some rebounds.
So we met.
So if I played her in basketball, she would destroy me.
Yeah, she'd whoop your
absolutely.
Ass.
What about a horse?
Yeah, you got a chance at horse.
You know how I'm good at
horse. You always have a chance at horse with your dart throwing
skills.
Exactly.
I would not bet against
you.
You
can move a
horse.
Ball or like objects in a direction.
Why do you call it dart throwing?
Because you throw
you're
the
like
basketball
like
someone
everything.
Throws a dart. That's
give him a javelin and it's like,
the only person I know throws a basketball.
You're right though, Justin.
You're like a spear thrower.
It's as if I'm a natural hunter.
I guess.
You know what I mean?
I guess, yeah.
We had to capture prey.
But could you kill something?
I would save your life.
You know that she remembers this. I don't remember this. She remembers us playing against each other before we ever really knew each other. So we used to play pickup games at the local 24-hour fitness.
And then you picked her up.
Hey. Wow. Yeah. And she used to play against us.
So ironic.
And that's how we met. But later when we started dating, we still would go play, but she played on my team. We never played against each other when we were together. But if
you play her now one-on-one,
I would get her.
You sure?
Yeah, I would get her. She knows I'd
you think
get
so?
Her. Yeah, like she talks some. She talks mad shit like she could, but she knows deep down that if I wanted to put it on.
She goes, hold on a second. Yeah.
Dude, she does like two moves, you're going to roll an ankle. That's my prediction.
No way, dude. No way. I still got game, bro.
I don't know.
I don't know.
You're built kind
of. You're just a little more brittle. That's
I will say I'm not as agile as I was.
Last time you sprinted, you pulled a hammy, right?
Oh, man.
Did you really?
That was playing fucking football on the beach, man. And
When you guys were being all hot dogging and shit.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, we were. That's a word from the 50s.
Hot
yeah. You guys were hot dogging. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You guys were all playing and you guys wanted me to go sprint up and down the beach. And I'm like, I'm cool, man. I'll chill right here.
Adam's like, watch me. I'm groovy.
Well, I was down there with my
high school buddies when we all played sports, right? So my best friends played football. My other buddy played basketball. I played basketball with him. And we were out, and so we've always played sports, and we really hadn't played anything like at all semi-competitively in a long time. And we were on the beach, and we had a football, and we're like, hey, let's get a little 3-on-3 action going on, and sounded like a good idea. And it was like second play, dude, like trying, I was wide receiver going damn out it, trying and sprinting in the sand. And it's like, what an idiot I am. I can't remember the last time I sprinted.
It's
much
a bad
less,
combo.
Yeah. And in the sand, that's like, note to self, don't do that. So yeah, I fucked up my hamstring for a while. Didn't do any major damage, just enough to be fucked up for about a week or two of not being able to do any leg exercises because of it. So strained it is what I did.
Getting old sucks.
Yeah. You know, it's
depressing to listen
the,
to.
The part yeah, the part about it though that
we're not even old.
I yeah, find humbling.
And we're old.
And the learning lesson so, that I have from that, because I used to hate when I was younger and somebody older would say that, right? That, oh, it's just a part of getting old and wait till you're older. And I know better
instead of
than
putting
that.
Putting the Asper cream on like before they even play.
Well, what you know happens? What happens is we when we talk
all the bands. And
we talk about this on the show all the time about you if you don't use it, you lose it, right? And you start to lose this connection because of the things that we do habitually, right? But we have these patterns now that we've created, and you know, it's way more. 10 years ago, it would be more common to find me on a basketball court, on a snowboard hill, or doing something extreme like that, you know, where now it would be more common to find me at a desk sitting in front of a laptop. Like that is, you would see me doing that more than you would see me. So it's, of course, then when I come out of that and I go decide I'm going to go play one of those sports, my body says, who do you think you
You're
are?
A creature of your environment.
Right, right.
You are, but there's definitely age-related effects. Like, you know, I'll tell you two things I notice for sure have to do with my age, 100%, because I'm very healthy with my diet, with my exercise. I do everything right, but there's
your
two
rage
things
at people that speed.
Yes.
Yeah. Ah! No,
there's two things that for sure have gone downhill since I've gotten older, because I'm 38, right? Number one, my tolerance for alcohol. Completely.
Oh, yeah.
No fucking way can I handle as much. I don't care how much I drink now and train myself. It just doesn't.
See, I find that like correlated like to the time that you start drinking, right? Because if it's like late, like I'm just not a late night, like 2 a.m., you know, like I immediately want to stop drinking around like, you know, 11.
Yeah, but were you always like that?
No.
Exactly.
That's what I mean. Like, I just know, I'm like, oh, this is going to...
He's saying that it's more time, though, than it is.
Well,
actually,
here's what I've noticed is that...
more than the alcohol.
So, you know how you start drinking... So, when I was, like, in my 20s, if I started drinking, it's 10 o'clock at night or whatever, we're out and we're drinking, that window of fun alcohol time was long. Like, I could fucking party for
totally
a while.
Yeah.
Now, if I start drinking, that fun buzz effect is like 2-3 hours, and then it's just tired.
Well, I okay,
man, I'm just sleepy.
So I have a theory. I have a theory problems on that. Because I've noticed my own patterns, and I am with you on the feeling of alcohol nowadays versus 15 years ago, and I think that it hits you different. Like when I would take a drink or two in the past, it wasn't like I would slam it to get. I would race to the mm-hmm getting drunk.
Oh, that was the goal.
Yeah, like to yeah get. You would want that really hard, almost to borderline. That was probably too much. And then you kind of like nursed this drunk feeling or a really heavy buzz feeling that you had for hours. Where now,
and
if I do, if
spinning,
I drink, it's way more casual and social with somebody because we're up at the suite watching a game, or we're, you know, at a very nice dinner, and so I'm having a glass of wine, or I just feel like taking the edge off. I'm at a comedy show, so I have a Crown and Coke. So it's very, very rare do I have these occasions. And then when I do that, it's one or two, and that puts me to sleep. Like one or two drinks makes me really
yeah, but,
sleepy after about a half hour.
But
if I were to pound four,
yeah,
I might be a different me.
Yeah, but it doesn't last as long, yeah, is my point. Like what happens
yeah
now.
Yeah, but when was the last time you shotgunned four beers?
Not beers, but I was just in Hawaii.
I
my
smell
girl
a challenge.
We, yeah, exactly. We had a don't challenge. See, don't say that around Justin, Adam.
You and your girl got drunk on your trip?
I'm excited.
Fuck yeah, we did. We there was one day where we were at the resort and we just got smashed. But it's funny because the fun alcohol time, like I said, it's only a couple hours long. And then if I try to like chase it, like, oh, I want to get that feeling back. All that ends up happening is I end up thinking about my life. You know what I'm saying? Like, all of a sudden, I'm just sitting there drinking. I'm just like, shit sucks right now. Like, what's going on over here? That used to never happen when I was younger. I'd drink and just, I could get myself in and out of this buzz state all day. You know what I mean? Mm. The second thing is sleep. When I was in my 20s,
oh, it's terrible for sleep.
For sure, I no joke, 5 hours of sleep, man, I was fire all day, fire, no problem. Yeah. Now, 5 hours of sleep, and
takes
I need
like
a
week to recover.
Exactly. It takes a little while.
That's so funny, because like when we were talking about going on vacation and everything, so I went to Reno, and like the we took this flight because it was cheap. And
You flew up there?
Yeah, we flew. It was nice, actually. It made it like so we had way more time to just chill. Right. But on the flip side, we got like the shitty time. Like, so 6 a.m. was when it like left, right? So the plan was from one of my friends to, we'll just stay up all night and then get on the plane.
Oh, God.
I was like, are you fucking like that?
What are we, 12?
It was like nine, it was like nails on a chalkboard, dude. You know, I was just like, I couldn't even fathom like staying up. Like, I was like, that just is a foreign animal. You know, but it's I could terrible. Totally do that like way back in the day.
It's terrible.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, you
I didn't. I was like, I'm going to bed.
We used to do that all the time. That, was a very, not a month went by that I didn't have a night where we didn't sleep at
That's
all.
That's what
it,
I'm saying.
It would be, and in fact, we used to, I remember in my early or late teens or whatever, we would play video games and that was it. We'd do video game marathons where it was like, go over to your buddies, spend the night, and like you would play through the night.
Yeah.
Through the night with no breaks at all.
You would beat the game.
Yes.
Yeah. That was the goal.
If I do that now, I'm ruined for probably a month. Like it doesn't happen.
Well, especially if you mix it with alcohol.
I thought about that.
If I mix alcohol and no sleep, it's a 3-day.
What about your tolerance for stimulants? Like, because back in the day, we used to take ephedrine when it was legal, and I could take that shit all day long. I can't tolerate that no more.
Oh, my God.
I do a little bit of that now. I get edgy.
What I wonder, though, because I know we're blaming a lot of this on being older, and I hate that. I fucking hate that. I don't believe in that.
At some point, though, it kicks in, right?
Okay,
you're not going to be 90.
Because technically, okay, you need less sleep as you get older. So technically...
Well, I'm not... okay, when I was like 12, yeah, I could sleep forever. I'm talking about like my 20s when...
I know, but what I'm saying is we age, we need less sleep. So, I mean, that shouldn't be something that should be declining as we get older. It should be getting better for us because we're needing less of it as we get older. The alcohol thing, I think that a lot of that is because we are more aware of our body and how our body's reacting to things. I think we were probably numb to a lot of stuff when we were shoveling shit in our mouth and eating whatever, drinking whatever, and just young and full of piss and vinegar, you know?
I have specific instances I could recall where I worked till 10 p.m. Me and the sales counselors or some trainers went out, like raged hard. I get home at, I don't know, 5 or 6 a.m. I slept for 2 hours. Went back to work the next day and just fucking hammered it out.
Yeah, but part of that I think is...
I could never do that.
Yeah, but anymore. Don't you think some of that is... Okay, so I remember...
Maybe
doing,
I just killed
I remember doing this also. I remember when we first started drinking in our, you know, again, late teens, early 20s, right? And we had this like idea of you're not really drunk until you throw up. And so we drank with the intention of like puking.
Healthy approach.
And there's no doubt in my mind that when I was puking my guts out, I had to feel like shit. But I think there was like this, it was like wearing it was like a badge of honor as a kid. Like it was like the not sleeping and being, I know I felt like shit the next day when I worked. I think I told myself like, fuck yeah, I feel miserable and I'm here. You know, like I think it was more like this chip on your shoulder where now you're older and you're wiser. It's like, if I can avoid that feeling, I'm going to.
Maybe.
So
maybe.
Hungover. Blah.
I want to agree with you because it's a nice state of mind to be in to be like, nah, but I don't know, man. I don't know. It's different.
I woke up in a bush.
Yeah.
It's like,
did you really?
I did one time. Yeah, Chicago. I think I told that story. Yeah.
You actually woke up in a bush?
I was so drunk. Yeah, I was like planning to meet up with my friend. I lost him and apparently just fell asleep, you know,
in a
park and then on top of a bush.
One of the worst stories I have is
that
I was
like the worst.
This was at whose party was it? Maybe it was Larry's going away party when he first or getting promoted. Something. It was this huge party and I woke up the next day. I don't remember whose house I was at. And I woke up on the couch and I had one shoe. I never found it, the other shoe.
Yeah.
I had one shoe.
Somebody took it.
I have no idea where it went. I asked people and they said I came home without a shoe, so I must have left it there. And I don't know why I didn't realize that I needed you know, I should get my other shoe. But that's the worst that could
happen. Wasn't that a thing? Like, people would take shoes off, they'd tie them and then throw them over the the power lines.
I forget what that used to represent. It used to stand for something. I fell into a cactus drunk. That was really fucking it was awful.
That's fun.
It was out of my cousin's. We used to throw these huge parties out of my cousin's house, and we slept inside my hatchback fucking Integra. So three full-size guys over 200 pounds sleeping in an Acura Integra, if you can imagine that. It's a hatchback, mind you, not a four-door.
You're like on top of each other.
Well, we folded the back seats down, and you slept into the trunk, into the back seat, and then one guy was in the front and laid the back to seat. So that's how we did it. And I was wasted and got up like at 3 o'clock in the morning to go pee. And I remember, too, it was so cold out there that we slept with my car cover. So everyone had we had my car cover in there, and we covered all of us with the car cover inside the car. It was freezing. And we're getting out to go to the restroom, and I'm standing over these bushes, which weren't bushes. They were a bunch of little, decorative type of cactuses, that were out there in pots. And I'm pissing on it, and because I'm so drunk, I can't keep my balance, and I start to fall over. And instead of letting my body fall into the cactus, I braced myself with my hands. Pissed all over myself, fell into the cactus.
Oh, no.
And it was one of those cactuses that wasn't the long ones. It was
little spiny.
So when I looked at my hands, and I remember sitting in the car, and I fell asleep trying to pull these out of my hands. And I woke up in the morning, and I looked like Puff the Marshmallow Man's hands. They were swollen, and they had red dots all over them, all these little tiny stickers that were stuck inside my hand. It was fucking awful.
That's gnarly.
Well, one of the worst memories of being wasted.
Hey, yeah, no, the first time I ever got sick was 21, in fact. No, I wasn't actually. I think I was 19. Yeah, I was 19.
Don't lie, right?
And my buddy there's a bar next to the 24 Fitness in Sunnyvale on Fremont Boulevard. What I'm talking about. And he took me there next door, and they let me in because I was the assistant manager, so they must have assumed that I was older, and just did a shit ton of tequila shots. And
oh my God.
This was my first time experiencing or understanding that it takes a second for the full effects to hit
you.
Yeah,
like...
Do you guys remember learning that lesson?
It doesn't happen like right away.
Yeah, so like I'm drinking them, and what's starting to hit me is the initial buzz, fun feeling.
Yeah.
And I'm like, fuck yeah, give me more. And we're just not realizing that the last three shots haven't fully hit me yet.
It's like lights out.
And I remember I'm doing them, and then all of a sudden I like got another shot. They poured it. It was on the bar. And I went to reach for it, and I was like, boo. Like, everything changed. You know what I mean? I was like, and I was like, dude, I don't know if I feel good. And he's like, you all right, buddy?
I bet you yacked
that night. And I'm like, oh, dude.
Ugh.
Oh, I threw up so
horrible.
Bad. And then to make matters worse, God, one of the most terrible things I ever did is I think I drove. I don't remember. I think I actually drove, which is a terrible thing.
I know.
That's the scary thing for me with kids.
I feel like with age is what you do. Like when you're younger, I remember pushing the limits with not a care of, like I was more concerned that I would drink for a night and not get wasted and get drunk because that was the mission as being younger. Getting older, I'm always flirting on the other end, right? I'd much rather have a night where I didn't feel any buzz or didn't feel anything at all.
Yeah.
But I don't want to get ever close to that awful feeling of drunk. So you're always kind of hanging on that side. Like, I know like now if I'm drinking with someone and someone's like, hey, you want another one? I'm like, I think I'm okay. Ask me in about an hour or so. Okay, I'll have another one.
Plus it's like
if I go hard, I'm like a water in between each one.
That's a great strategy, by the way.
Plus you have it's like you have one day of that you can do. Like if you go on a trip, because I've done this in the past too, where I'd go on a trip for 5 days and every day we drink and party. Now if I go on a trip for 5 days, like it's going to be one of those days, and that's about it. I don't want to do any more after that. Like,
no, I agree.
You know what I'm saying?
And you want to be strategic.
You kind of need to do one, just for old times.
Yeah. The three of us, we've only done it. I think we only
like
drank
one time in Austin. Like,
was that the only
wild,
time?
But that was about it.
Were we out or was that at the house?
And really, I think only Justin got drunk that night.
Probably.
Justin was great.
I was a little lit. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know why? Because it took so long. We were the only people there for a while. Like, I had to do something.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah. What about
crushing Moscow Mules at the house and then we were.
Oh, yeah.
And then we did the
we've done
webinar.
Moscow Mules, yeah.
Not a webinar. We did the live on the Facebook forum.
Yeah, we've had some. We've done.
We weren't really.
I mean, Justin is the only one that's probably would enjoy drinking, more. I think the two of us are a bunch of pussies.
I'm the Irish one.
Well, I mean, Sal and I would rather get high.
That's true.
I'd rather get stoned out of our mind. That just sounds
true.
I'd wake up the next day way better feeling.
Yeah.
Than, 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 yeah. You get me smashed on alcohol the next day. There's 9 times out of 10. I'm gonna be awful, grouchy, not feeling good, craving bad food. Bleh, like just don't like that.
Yeah,
you can get me higher than I've ever been in my life and have the worst paranoia and hide in the closet all night. But I'll wake up the next day fine. Yeah, you know, yeah. The next day I'm like ready to go for a normal day.
So you also don't.
See, that makes me groggy though.
What, the next day?
Smoking? Yeah,
you can. If you get like, super. Ugh. Yeah, you can wake up the next day and kind of feel out of it. But
if you did too much.
If you did a whole bunch, but you don't do anything stupid typically. You know what I mean?
Well, you're not really functional enough.
I've never done anything where the next day I was like, oh fuck, man, I got too stoned and then I did all that crazy. Never. It was always like
so many people and made inappropriate. Yeah. I got in a fight. Out.
No, it was like no, I got paranoid.
You ate too much. Watched some shitty movie.
Yeah,
That's what I really am interested to see like when we get, because we're not far from this, right? I mean, we're every day it seems like another state legalizes marijuana. Before long, you know, there'll be as many pot shops and clubs that allow marijuana as there are clubs and bars, right? And when that day comes, I'm really interested to see like what type of stats come out with, you know, fights and violence and that. Because
just look at Colorado, we just pull those stats up, I'm sure,
right? Yeah. And everything's on the decline. Like I've been in so many more fights and altercations and bad scenarios,
alcohol related.
Yep. That I can't even name all of them, but I can't tell you a time that where my friends and I got really high and then got into some serious trouble. Like we did something, it was like we ate all the cookies that my mom said not to eat. You know, like that was like the trouble we got into. Like save those for Sunday. I have guests coming over. And we ate them all.
Ate all of them. Yeah, that's the other thing about getting old that I realized too. You have this like this sort of like ultra sensitive like radar. You know what I mean? Like for trouble. So like I was watching the McGregor and Mayweather fight, and you know, this room is packed with like tons of people and drinks are happening, you know, like everywhere. And you start listening comments, you know, some people like are getting a little rowdy.
Right. And I'm you're
like,
an idiot.
Oh my God. I'm like picking them out. I'm like, okay, this person. Okay. That person. I'm looking for the door. Oh, the exit's over here. You know what I'm saying? Like in case like some shit goes down, like you just have this like,
It's totally true. And when you're younger, I think when you're younger, you still have the same sensitivity. The difference is
you're attracted to it.
Yeah.
The younger,
you call it on, you summon it.
You know what I used to do? This is the bane of testosterone, because it makes you do these stupid decisions. If I was somewhere and there was a loud whatever or an asshole and it's in the corner, it has nothing to do with me,
you go over to it.
I'd walk over in that direction and be like, I dare you to try.
Come on.
Yeah, let's see what happens.
Pal.
Here. Or if somebody would cut someone else off on the freeway, and I'd be like, oh, cool, I'm going to come up to speed up to that guy and see if he does that
shit
to me.
Huh?
Now,
I like braking.
Yeah, now as like a full-grown adult, I see something like that, like, I'm going to walk over here.
Let this asshole do his thing.
Yeah. Let them kill each other.
Yeah.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
Our first question is from Danielle CF2000.
I can do it.
How do you deal with a client who is hyper-flexible and has a hard time feeling stretches that commonly work for IT band and the hip flexor area?
So there's two things I want to address here.
I'm confused a little bit too.
So hyper-flexible client, they're trying to get them to stretch their IT band and their hip flexor.
A little unstable.
But they're not able to feel it because...
Well, good luck stretching your IT band, first
right,
of all.
Right, right. Here's what's happening here. What you're probably trying to do is you're trying to use stretches to alleviate the feeling of tightness in those two areas. Obviously, this person's hyperflexible, so they're not actually tight, but they may feel, you know, some pain or some discomfort in those areas, so you're trying to stretch them out to help. Here's the thing with stretching those areas. It is a temporary fix anyway. Unless that's the reason for the pain, if I have a pain in my bicep and I stretch it, it might alleviate it temporarily. It might help it permanently if the reason for the pain is tightness, but if it's not the reason for it, then what stretching is doing is it's causing temporary pain relief. So number one, with this particular client, you need to figure out why their IT band and hip flexors feel like they need to be stretched. If this person's hyperflexible, it's likely not because they don't have the flexibility. Mm. It's likely because there is a muscle imbalance and a strength issue, which is far more common.
It keeps firing at a really high level.
Either that or it's just not doing what it should because they're hyperflexible.
What I would guess from this, because they're saying IT band and hip flexor area, so I'm assuming up by the hip is she's got probably some sort of hip issue that there she's complaining about. And if they're hypermobile, then it's probably a strength and mobility issue with the hips. Sure. So I would mobilize the hips and then strengthen the hips, because it's one thing to be mobile, so maybe they can get in a 90-90 and they look super Gumby and flexible, but how much strength do they have?
Can they lift their leg up?
And right.
Can they, internally, externally rotate?
Right. How much strength and control do they have in their hips? So different movements... we just did an episode where we talked about sumo deadlifts, right? Like, here's an exercise where you're externally rotating the feet, and that rotates the femur out. And so this is going to strengthen the hips in a different position than people are normally related to. So I would challenge her with movements like that, or like Kosh check squats, or like what else would be good? Like
Cossack squats.
Cossack.
What did I say?
Kosh check.
Kosh check.
Fucking twice I've done
he's
that.
The
now. Yeah, I know. Right. I did it twice.
He has his own squats too.
He probably does. He just throws an extra.
I don't know why I always want to give him the credit for those squats.
Hey, he was a good fighter. Right?
They're around a long
give
time.
Give him something. Away. You know what I mean?
Multi-planar lunges, like anything where we were challenging the mobility and the strength. I did a video with Dr. Jordan Shallow. Great video on Bulgarian squats. I think so. Your Bulgarian split squats would be a great exercise for someone like this. Really challenge their strength in that deeper range of motion too. And by doing the split squats, by creating an unstable environment or unilateral by holding the dumbbell on one side, like this type of stuff to strengthen that area, I think would be ideal.
Hyperflexibility and hypermobility is an interesting problem to work with as a trainer, primarily because it's not common. Mm-hmm. I've had clients like this, and I can remember all of them. That's how infrequently I see this. But I've definitely had them where they come in.
I've only had it with like the super yoga guru, like the person who's only into yoga.
Oh no, I've had a couple female clients who they were not conditioned, so it's not like they were doing yoga or anything like that. And they'd come in and you could just, first off, their posture wasn't great because they didn't have the strength to support their posture. But when they'd go into a stretch, it was like they fold right in half.
Yeah.
Hips super flexible, shoulder super flexible, and they have issues controlling weight many times.
That was the thing. I had like a 15-year-old girl that my client, she brought in, for me to help kind of strengthen and train. And it was like she was so flexible, could do the splits and multiple angles and gymnastics and kind of go through the momentum of the movements. But then when we slow it down and break it down and get her into sitting in a squat and doing all these sorts of things, it was just like the control just wasn't there and her whole body's just kind of all over the place.
Tension is key with this.
Yeah.
So what I found to work best with these clients, especially when they first start off, let's say I have somebody who has got hyperflexibility or hypermobility in the hips, I will put them in like a 90-90 or even a pigeon, yoga pigeon position. And then without doing an exercise, I'll have them push against the floor or pull away from the floor. Basically, just activate the muscles that they're stretching in the stretch position and practice that and then slowly move out of it and then practice activating
there. We did a great video of what you're explaining right now with Dr. Brink on Mind Pump TV. So if you're not subscribed to Mind Pump TV, this is the type of stuff that we put on there. Make sure you get on there. And so all the videos that have a blue, so we have playlist. If you don't know how to use that, go to the playlist. And all the videos that have the blue logo, which is our MAPS Prime Pro, those are excellent exercises for this person and in this condition. Plus the Jordan one that I'm telling you, Bulgarian squats. If you have it sounds like if they got hip flexor issues and IT stuff,
it's gluteus medius, gluteus minimus, it's TFL.
Yeah,
those are all the muscles that are weak.
Right, and these are all muscles responsible for stabilizing the whole your whole pelvic and hip area. And it's so
forced to have to stabilize
these right. are Bulgarian the squat. These are the people that isometric training has a huge benefit.
Yeah.
If you can, because I've taken people like this, like I've said, and I've done traditional resistance training. It's very hard to train people like this
mm-hmm.
because they're so limber and so loose. They have issues controlling the weight. The full range of motion is hard to judge because the range of motion is so freaking
well, yeah,
massive.
And they're kind of going through their movements with momentum. And so, like, yeah, when you go just to pick up, like, to load that, you know, sequence is dangerous, you know, like to... So, like you said, like, isometrics are perfect for that because if we're trying to, like, get them to really sit in the squat or, you know, a position where it's the end range position mm-hmm. where you want them to get comfortable in that and have that control, you have to be able to communicate properly. And that's one of the best ways to communicate
completely.
To your body.
Yeah. So, what I would do, for example, a normal person, let's say I did a push-up with a normal person, right? You know, 2 to 4 seconds down, 2 seconds up, right? So, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2 on the way up. A person like this, I may do one of two things. I may have them do one rep, but that entire negative is going to take them 20 seconds, and then the positive is going to take them just as long. So they're doing this super slow motion, tense, controlled rep, and it's one. And I'll do the same thing with a row or a squat or any other movement. Or I'll have them get into a position where they're supporting their weight or supporting a barbell and then just holding it there and slowly, incrementally move them through different positions. Because with hyperflexibility or mobility and with a lack of strength, you are looking at big-time dysfunction. You're looking at big-time dysfunction at the joints. You're looking at problems with pain. And that's just based on this question, I can guarantee that's what she's seeing. I mean, if there's IT band issues, hip flexor issues, and they're hyperflexible, it's because they have they don't have a good enough strength to support
mostly
that.
Mostly a strength issue.
That's it. Quick commercial break. Hey, people ask us all the time how they can support Mind Pump. Here's what you can do. You can go to www.brain.fm/mindpump and get 20% off Brain FM for meditation or focus. You can also go to audibletrial.com/mindpump and get a 30-day trial plus one free audio book. Lastly, you can go to getnatureblend.com/mindpump and you will get a discount on Ben Greenfield's CBD product.
Next up is Joy873. What are the differences between body weight and weights for muscle building?
Well, for muscle building, there's a huge difference.
So go ahead if you want to.
No, it's just, I mean, you can only go so far with body weight. I think body weight is awesome. I think it's incredible for proprioception. I think that everybody should intermittently add body weight movements into their routine. I think you can actually build a very good physique only through body weight. But if you say the word muscle building, and that is your goal, is to build as much muscle as possible, you will be limited with just body weight. And eventually, if you want to continue to build more muscle and grow, you just cannot compare body weight to training with weights.
No, mainly the reason that's true is because you're limited by how much you weigh.
Right, you're overloading the muscle.
Yeah, so I'll give you guys so I know there's a lot of people who, they confuse this, right? And so they'll say, oh, body weight exercises are good, but you're going to build more muscle with weights because weights are superior for building muscle, as if free weights have some magical component to them that makes them better at building weights. The reality is, I can load a lot more weight on the bar.
You're just loading the same movements.
That's it, because those same people will then say, oh, pull-ups are great for building muscle. Like, well, that's a body weight movement.
Yeah.
Handstand push-ups, great for, well, because that's a body weight movement, but you're lifting more of your weight. Both of them are extremely beneficial for building muscle. Like Adam was saying, the limiting factor is your body weight. Like push-ups, I'm not going to be lifting that much weight when I do push-ups as if I were doing a bench press where I could put, you know, 200-300 pounds on the bar. But if I angle my body a particular way, if I use like rings or I do one-armed exercise, like one-arm push-ups, now I'm getting a pretty good muscle-building effect.
Yeah, well, you're intensifying the gravitational forces. So basically you're trying to compensate, you know, for the lack of load by adding, you know, these other variables. So it's like, it's different. You know, it's good, but it's different. And honestly, I feel... It's a great as a prerequisite, you know, to be able to really get connected to your body.
Well, you're just giving Drew this advice today.
Mm-hmm.
Today, one of our employees was asking Justin questions about what he should be doing training wise, and Justin already assessed him a little bit and looked at what was going on. And he's got so many imbalances and issues that Justin advised him not to be lifting weights. It's like, you're just going to, until you're, because he saw his squat and how fucked up it was. And he's actually a fit,
in shape. Yeah, he looked like, he's like, he's strong already and everything, but it's just so many things like just popped out right away that like need attention. And for me to not overwhelm him right away and be like, oh, you need to do this as your primer, you need to do this to correct this imbalance and, you know, kyphosis and all these different issues and things that I see. I want you to just get connected to your body and to focus on a few things that, you know, we can tweak and adjust. And yeah, I will be adding all those things to help correct and get you to get on the right path as far as like, this is the optimal recruitment pattern to kind of hone in on. But until then, you could definitely push up. You can definitely, you know, air squat. You can do these basic fundamental movements, you know, just with body weight to strengthen, you know, those types of movements because you need them.
Yeah, right? And there's something to be said about being able to manipulate your body versus manipulating a weight. Both have value, okay? So I want to be clear here. Both of them have functional value. Both of them will make you move better. Both of them will contribute to athletic performance, but they're both unique in a couple different ways. With body weight movements, if I practice body weight movements, I get really comfortable with moving my body around in space. Now think about how valuable that is in sports and in everyday life. Being able to move my body, be able to catch my body with my hand, to press myself up.
Which is the definition of proprioception.
Absolutely, right? Absolutely. Now with weights, you know, moving weights around your body is important too. Sports, that's important, and so is everyday life when I'm lifting things and moving things. Both should be incorporated in your routine. I don't think you should negate either one of them. I think an ideal routine, even an ideal muscle building routine,
still incorporates,
utilizes... Absolutely, utilizes both of them, and whichever one you don't do, you end up getting bad at. Like, I can't do a pistol squat because why? Because I've never done them. I never practiced them. I definitely have the strength to squat my whole body weight up with one leg. I know that, but I don't have the proprioceptive ability or the mobility to do it because I've never practiced it. Now, is that going to take away from my overall function? Yeah, of course it does. I mean, there may be a, you know, certain movements and stuff that I do in everyday life, or if I play a sport, God forbid, that involves me using one leg in a squat or whatever, that I'm not going to be able to do very well because I never practiced that movement. So the key to doing this is to combine both of them. I would say incorporate both of them. It's a good thing to incorporate both of them, even in every workout. So doing, if you're hitting your chest, to incorporate some type of a body weight movement, maybe at the end of your workout or dips, for example, or back, do some kind of a pull-up.
Yeah, it's a great way to build volume. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Next is happy, healthy, and free. How do you get better at deep breathing on a regular basis? She is always breathing shallowly.
This is a good question because a lot of people don't think about this.
Yeah.
They don't really realize that this has a tremendous effect on how you feel. Mm-hmm. There's a feedback mechanism with your body in which your everything from your body position to your facial to the faces you make to your breathing will tell your body what you should feel, and then vice versa. What your body's feeling will then influence your breathing, your body posture, and the face you make. And there's lots of studies to support this. You could take somebody and have them purposefully smile, and they will find themselves then naturally wanting to smile. Or you can even practice this right now. You can pretend laugh for the next 30 seconds and you'll find yourself laughing for real. Breathing is one of those things. If you are in a deep, relaxed state, then your breathing is deep. It's slower. It's what's called a full diaphragmatic breath, where the diaphragm inflates or breathes in completely, where you feel it in your belly. And you breathe out fully, and it's more of a slow breath.
It's expansive.
Yeah. If you're excited, energized, angry, scared, you're going to have faster breath, more shallow breath. That's going to produce quicker energy in the short run. In the long run, it'll exhaust you very quickly. And if you've ever had an anxiety attack or if you ever get stressed out, you know what that feels like, where all of a sudden you get tired from breathing this way. Now, my girlfriend Jessica blew my mind a while ago with on this particular topic, because we were talking about recruitment patterns. of the body. And we were talking about,
she just went down to Paul Check. Right?
She did, and they were talking about the importance of breathing. And this is actually something that she came up with. I actually thought it was Check that taught this, and she said no, she corrected me. This is something that she came up with when we were having the discussion, is that, you know, there are muscles involved with breathing, in particular the diaphragm, to a lesser extent the intercostals, which are involved in...
Which is part of your core.
That's right. And you can definitely develop a recruitment pattern that becomes your default recruitment pattern with those muscles, not unlike the recruitment pattern you may develop, you know, through proper or improper squatting or walking or running or whatever, to where your body learns this particular way of doing something. So that becomes your default. Mm-hmm. And with breathing, it's even more so, because breathing is something that we do kind of subconsciously.
Yeah.
Like, you don't sit there
and you're always trying to make it as efficient as possible.
Yeah, and you're not thinking about it. Like, you're just breathing. Mm. So if you're not thinking about something, then you just kind of go into this default pattern. Well, if you are always shallow breathing, you're going to have to do kind of a regimented training to retrain your body how to breathe. So this doesn't happen on accident. Yeah, you actually have to practice this.
I can completely attest to that, and that makes a lot of sense, because ever since I did the Wim Hof technique and you know, the ice bath and all that, like, it really forced the issue. Like, it forced the issue for me. You know, the whole class, we got into it and we really worked on the full diaphragmatic breath and getting into that really deep power breath. And I never even really, like, I have to intentionally do that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's just not, it's not something that I'm going to repeat throughout the day. So unfortunately, I'm trying to work it up where I'm ramping that up throughout the week, where it's more frequently making it into my habits. But for now, I do it every weekend. And it's been totally a game changer for me.
How long do you take doing it?
It usually takes about like a half an hour, I think.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, just because I go through like three cycles, and I go through like the, what's it like 30 really deep breaths. And then after that, you hold. And then, you know, you release. And then you hold your breath again. And then you go through the cycle again. So, I mean, it takes a while, and I guess, like, it's not really 30 minutes. After that, I do some mobility work, because you're so relaxed and you're so, like filled up with this, like, clarity and energy and everything. So it's like mobility makes, like, perfect sense.
Has it impacted your everyday breathing? Have you noticed an improvement or change?
I think it does, for mainly when I have that immediate response to tighten up and kind of hunch forward. Like, so I don't do that as much anymore. Like, I feel like if there's a stressful situation, I'm less likely to tighten, you know. That's not, like, my mechanism has always been that. So that's really helped, you know.
So a couple exercises you could do for this. One of them is you can lay on your back. This is a very basic, simple exercise to help you belly breathe. So you lay on your back, you place one hand right above your belly button and one hand on your chest. And you take a deep breath in, and the goal is to have the hand that's on your belly rise up to its max before your chest starts to rise, and then let your chest rise up. So belly first, chest second. And then when you breathe out, it's chest first, belly second. And it's hard to do at first.
Through your nose?
Yeah. You can do it through your nose or through your mouth. But
okay, we do it through the nose.
But you'll find it very difficult to do if you've never done it before. So it's going to take some practice, and you may find some interesting release when you do this. I've had people have emotional release from practicing this because they all of a sudden let go of their stress. The second thing you could do is you could take a timer, and you can breathe in as deep as you possibly can. Hold your breath for 10 seconds. See if you could suck in any more air, and you usually can. Hold that for another 10 seconds. Breathe in even more air if you can, and then hold your breath as long as you can. And what you're doing is you're stretching your lungs and teaching your diaphragm to suck in more and more air. And do like 5 to 10 cycles of this and see if you can hold your breath longer and not longer each time. And it should help you become a little more connected to your breath.
This is, you know, I'm sure people are probably getting tired of hearing me say this, but I tell you what, man, Brain FM has been a game changer for me. And this is, I'm almost every night, probably every other night, because it's not that consistent. I know there's some nights where I don't feel like I need to, but, you know, there's a guided meditation inside Brain FM also. And, you know, it's kind of stepping you through the breathing process. And it just, it helps to have that. Like, it's got calming music playing, and then it's got someone talking in my ear, how to breathe. And it, I can literally feel my body completely change the energy and everything when it, when I settle down and settle in and actually get my breathing right. And it does take a few before it gets there. It, it, and I've gotten better at it that it takes less. Like the first time I did it, it was like frustrating. Like, this is stupid. I don't notice anything. You know, like that, that was the attitude I had. And then the more I practiced it, I realized like, oh shit, okay. Now I can feel myself really, really settle down. Now I can do about 5 to 10 breaths that, and I could get myself to get that state change.
Do you get? Do you guys notice when you do these breathing exercises that you that you'll halfway through doing them you'll find yourself yawning? Have you noticed that yet?
I don't know if I yawn, but I can feel like this. I go,
yeah.
I so, can just feel like my whole body, yeah. Like I can feel.
I don't get lightheaded anymore.
I feel everything slows down.
So pay attention and see if you yawn, because one thing that I've noticed, and I think yawning may be connected to that shift in from, you know, sympathetic to parasympathetic.
Oh, okay.
Where all of a sudden somebody will start to yawn, and that's when I know, because I've noticed this with my clients when we're doing these breathing exercises. Mm. Like, you know, after 5 or 6 of them, all of a sudden they yawn, and I know like, oh cool. Like we're starting to hit that state.
Yeah, I don't know if I noticed that.
Tell me, yeah, it was like an oxygen exchange or what, like some kind of chemical exchange there that made you yawn.
I'm not quite sure. That's a good question.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think you brought that up. The need that your body's wanting more of one than the other, and so it's just
some kind of there's like a discrepancy.
Well, there's a couple theories. I know one of them is it's like an empathetic. It's like you're trying to garner empathy from people around you.
Hmm.
Same reason why we have tears when we cry. Like you're like, why do we have?
Oh,
tears?
Oh, that's why it's contagious.
Yes, yes, because it's like this instinctual thing. Like we're trying to show people some type of emotion.
Feel you. Yeah.
And then people get empathetic to you. Same. That's again why they theorize why we cry and we actually have tears. It's so people around you can see.
So visibly they know.
They know that you're sad and be empathetic because we're such
I'm a good person.
We're such social
I'm a crier. I'm a crier.
But you know, with the other thing you can do too, because when people talk about like I'm always breathing shallowly, focusing on breathing and working on that will help quite a bit with that anxious kind of stress, you know, feeling that you're having.
Totally.
But there's a lot of other things you could do as well. You could also learn to meditate. If you're in such a stress state where you're just fucking anxious, and I've been in this state before, and I've had clients in this state before where you tell them to meditate, you tell them to belly breathe, and they just can't even get into that. They can't even do that because they're so, they're so like, you know what I mean? So anxious. And this is when I'll recommend certain herbs and supplements that I know, you know, within 30 minutes to 45 minutes will kind of help bring them down a little bit and get them into that state. So reishi is one of them, which you know you guys know I've been using at night. Reishi is a fantastic.
The Four Sigmatic one?
That's the one I've been using is Four Sigmatic. I really like their, and they've got a good dose of it in there because with reishi, I've noticed if you take a small dose, take a decent dose.
Well, and I feel like Four Sigmatic is one of those companies that's good at this. They talk about dosage. I've caught other companies where they put like, oh, reishi in there, and then it's like such a small dose of it that I was going to ask you, like, what is a solid dose of that so people know? Do you know what like kind of like the?
Yeah, I believe it's 1,000 to 3,000 milligrams, if I'm not mistaken.
Because some supplement companies, because they know there's a lot of hype around reishi, they'll throw it in there in their proprietary blend or say they got them out, and it's so minimal. I was curious. And I know how much you like.
I know it's in the I know it's in the like at least 1,000 milligrams, if I'm not mistaken, maybe as high as 5. But the Four Sigmatic has a decent dose in it. They also test everything for you know toxins and pesticides and all that stuff. And then the way they extract it, there's like a dual extraction process. But nonetheless, reishi is one of those things that I'll use at night, and I notice if I'm super edgy, 30, 45 minutes later, I feel myself feel a little bit better, and then I get into the real effective stuff like the meditation or the belly breathing, and it makes it so much easier. So reishi is a good one. Passion flower, you can use passion flower is a good one. These are more acute. Ashwagandha is more of a long-term, like you might feel a little bit of relaxing.
Do they have a passion flower?
No, they don't. That'll get in a tincture form.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's not a mushroom.
Would you combine that with?
So if you combine too many or a lot of relaxing things together, you can get a compounding effect, and it might not be a good thing. It might get a little too sedative. I know passion flower's pretty potent in that sense, in the sense that you take it, and if you take too much of it, you can feel kind of almost drunk.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, from it.
Oh, wow. Sweet.
But like I said, you could use...
Let's make it a weekend.
You could use some of those herbs. The reason why I like reishi is because it's it can be used on a more long-term basis. It's not necessarily for acute. It could also be for chronic issues. But doing that first, 30 minutes later, now you're in a better state. Go do your breathing exercises. But you got to do them regularly. If it is a dysfunction in the muscle recruitment patterns of your diaphragm, your intercostals, and your core, then just then frequency is going to be key. Like literally, and the cool thing about breathing exercises is they take about 5 minutes. So I would say do this, you know, 3-4 times a day while you're sitting at your desk, while you're in your car, whatever. And within a few weeks, you should notice that it's just carries over, and you get a better breathing all the time.
Quick commercial break, you guys. We keep getting asked all the time, how can I support the Mind Pump family? Here's one of the best ways you guys can. You guys love that Chimera coffee that we have. Chimera coffee with a K. You go to chimeracoffee.com, put in the discount code Mind Pump for 10% at the checkout. If you guys have not tried Ben Greenfield's new bars out, they're fantastic. If you want some, go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/naturebite, put in the code Mind Pump and get 10% off. Go check it out.
Santa GT is a competitive hockey player in college. After skating, he tends to notice tightness in shins, calves, hips. Any tips to help?
Well, this is probably a mobility issue for sure. Like just, I remember feeling this way just from like squatting. I would get like this because I was not addressing my ankle mobility. Mm-hmm. I was not, when the shins are on fire like that and the calves, I would address ankle mobility, which we have great videos on Mind Pump TV for free. If you want more extensive knowledge on that, my Maps Prime Pro dives really deep into the foot, the ankle, the hand, the wrist, like every area of the body, every joint, every major joint of the body we address there. So calves and shins, my guess is you're limited on your ankle mobility. And so that's probably why they're bothering you. And then hips. And
traveling all
the
way up.
How much mobility is allowed in a, not much, right? In hockey skates, right?
Oh, yeah. For like ankle wise and all that. Yeah, because everything's locked in.
Everything's locked in.
That's why the exterior work, you know, the accessory stuff is so important to do.
Yeah, most of the time, tightness in the shins is because there's a weakness in the tibialis muscle that's in the shin. I rarely have ever encountered, I actually can't even think of a time. Have you guys ever encountered someone with a tibialis that was so tight you needed to stretch it? I've never seen that. I don't think so.
Yeah, I doubt it's a stretching thing. More than likely they're on
strength.
And they're on fire because they're, you know, think about that. You're skating, right? And well, you're stopping, going left and right. And so he's getting these real sharp movements, left, right, back, forward. And he's locked into this position.
Yeah, it's
with
that locked position is really that's killing it.
Right, right. And so they're just firing like crazy. And we're addressing all the ankle mobility and then stabilization type stuff. So we talked earlier on this episode, I think, too. Again, this is another person who would benefit a lot from the Bulgarian split squat. So doing Bulgarian, so work on the mobility first, and then a great exercise is the Bulgarian squat, and then our Prime Pro program.
Prime Pro, my God, that would blow. Oh, yeah. That would blow him away.
Amazing for that. Yeah.
That would blow him away
for sure. And then the hips, right? So he says the hips are an issue too, which again, it's probably more of a strength mobility issue. So addressing the mobility.
Yeah, so interesting to, you know, think back to, because I remember even in football when I was playing and practicing, just the difference in fields would make such an impact for me on my shins and, you know, the tightness of my hips and the calves and, like, you know, my legs would just take a beating with a really hard field. And you know, like all these kind of factors, like I wish I would have known, you know, to mobilize my ankles, you know, better and like get more of these types of movements that I could pattern throughout the day to really like help to aid in that. And, you know, I wouldn't have felt that, you know, that it was painful, man.
Well, this is when you get to the now, and you're starting to see this bleed into college and even high school at some of the elite high schools that you get, right, with these you know, you have the you know, top of the or the cream of the crop type of coaches and trainers that are helping these professional athletes, and this is the type of shit that they know that they help these guys with, is, you know, the athlete just goes into play, right? And he just does what he's told.
Yeah, I feel you don't really get that till the, like, the professional, maybe like Division One kind of realm. Like, I mean, I'm sure it's getting better now, but, you know, back
I think
in the
it's trickling down now because obviously with more information, more knowledge, I think we're learning the importance of this, of starting early. Because as a kid, you can probably, and I don't know how young this guy is that's playing hockey or not, but, you know, in your early years, you can get away. Like, it's like, it's just nagging, right? Like, when I was playing basketball as a kid, I was just like, it's nagging, but it didn't stop me from playing every day. But if I would have, I wish I would have known what I know now, because, you know, it probably could have hindered my performance a little bit. Yeah. And had I...
If you're constantly feeling the same pain all the time, it's like chronic.
It's like, your body telling you.
Like, no, you're not going to just ignore it. Like, you need to do something different.
Well, the old advice was just ice your shins afterwards, you know, and then, you know, maybe tape them up or whatever.
Right.
Here's some takeaways. Right after your games, right after your hard practices, deep tissue massage on these areas and stretch. So this is after, not before. So right after, give yourself a good 30 to 60 minutes of deep stretching in these areas. Then the second part is, on your training days that you're not actually playing, do exercises specific to these areas. So I would do reverse calf raises. That's where you, or what are they called? Toe raises, where you lift up your toes towards your shin. Strengthen the tibialis.
Combat stretch.
Yep. Do some foot exercises. You can look up short foot. That's a good exercise for the feet. And then for the hips, do some 90-90 exercises. We have videos on YouTube for those. Do those, you know, maybe two or three times a day on the days that you're not doing, you're not playing a hard game, and watch them start to get better.
But, and all of that is in Prime and Prime Pro. So
because here's the thing, like, we don't know specifically what your issue is. We're just based this off your question.
Right.
But if I were to work with you personally, I would I would do a full assessment. I would watch you move. I would do different things with you, because then I can really pinpoint what some of the issues are.
You'll feel your way through it. As long as you have, like, the right movement that you're working on, like, you'll feel the difference. Like, oh, I need to work on this.
I mean, it's, for me, it's pretty obvious, because think about that. If your shins and calves both, like, those muscles are responsible for the movement of the ankle, right? So it's not one or the other, it's both of them. Both of them are being affected by that. So right away, I know there's a limiting factor on your ankle mobility. And if you strengthen that you should right away see some sort of relief in calves. And then if you add in all the stuff that Sal's saying, then you should really, and the hips are probably the same thing. So I feel pretty confident, even without even seeing this person, based off of what they're explaining and then knowing their sport, that it's pretty confident that it's a ankle mobility issue. And if you address that, and by mobility issue, it's not just that you can't mobilize or move your ankle, but, you know, strengthening that in its fullest range of motion. And so doing the exercises Sal's talking about, and then if you have the ability or can afford Prime and Prime Pro, I would highly recommend utilizing that, because that's not only going to address what you're asking right here, but anything else that you could, that could come out in the future.
He's a college student. Tell you what, Santa GT, if you're listening right now, DM me on Instagram, and I'll see if I can somehow see if I can take care of you a little bit with those, because it would really benefit you. That's an inside joke. Nobody knows what's going on there. Check this out. Go to mindpumpmedia.com. 30 days of coaching. It's free. It's for everyone. Costs you nothing. Go in there and register. Also, if you want to ask us a question on an episode like this one, the place to do it is on Instagram. Just go to our page, Mind Pump Media. Find the Q&A or the Qua picture,
the Qua,
and ask your question underneath. Make sure to hashtag Qua, Q-U-A-H. Also, we all have personal Instagram pages too. Mine is Mind Pump Sal. Justin is Mind Pump Justin. And Adam is Mind Pump Adam.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.